At the close of summer in 1087, William the Conqueror, the Norman Duke who had wrested England from the Anglo-Saxons, lay dying at the Priory of St. Gervas near Rouen. Only weeks earlier, William had been in the saddle, commanding his men in an attack on Mantes. While the town was being burnt, William had fallen ill. He'd remained active to the end, but by now, the one-time tireless warrior king was old and obese, his energy waning. The illness was serious enough that he withdrew to a sickbed at St. Gervas. As William's condition worsened, anxiety increased among his vassals. William had inherited the Duchy of Normandy from his father, but it was by a spectacular conquest that he'd seized the Kingdom of England. William destroyed England's old Anglo-Saxon power structure with ruthless violence. Northern England he'd subdued through a campaign of shocking brutality that produced masses of wandering, starving orphans. Out of this carnage, William had created a cross-channel empire, joining Normandy with England. But this new political structure was largely held together by the force of William's personality. Now, as the Norman nobles stood around the king's deathbed, they wondered what was coming next. Rebellion? Chaos? Upheaval on both sides of the channel? The violence of William's conquest of England had scandalized all of Christendom. Many wondered if God would ultimately punish the endeavor. The 11th century was a time of deep religious belief in which no one doubted the consequences of God's anger. William himself was certainly conscious of his sins. As he lay dying, he released many of his prisoners, including Wulfnoth, brother to Harold Godwinson, the Anglo-Saxon king slain during William's conquest. William also made lavish donations to the church and appropriated vast sums for the relief of the poor. The Norman chronicler, Ordric Vitalis, tells us that the king, as he made his deathbed confession, expressed great sorrow and regret over the bloodshed involved in England's conquest. Throughout his long final illness, William remained lucid, explaining his last wishes to those gathered around him. To his eldest son, Robert Curthose, William left the Duchy of Normandy. To his second eldest son, William Rufus, the king bequeathed England. Then, on the morning of September 9th, William awoke and announced that he was commending his soul to the Virgin Mary. Then he died. The hours that followed were chaotic. The Norman nobles, who'd so dutifully attended their lord's deathbed, abandoned the king's body. Some, expecting upheaval, rushed off to fortify their castles. Some even expelled the garrisons installed by William himself, installing their own men in their place. In the streets of Rouen, people wandered about as if in a daze, anguished over thoughts of what could be coming. William had been a hard ruler, but he'd brought stability and predictability. Meanwhile, at the Priory of St. Gervas, servants plundered the room where William had died. The body was left lying exposed on the floor. The clergymen and monks of the city, recovering from their initial shock, finally organized a funeral procession. But with all the nobles and servants having fled, there was no one to prepare the body. At last, a simple country knight, by the name of Erluin, took it upon himself to make the arrangements. He found William's corpse lying naked in the barren room at St. Gervas, everything having been stolen, including the king's clothes. Finally, the Archbishop of Rouen had the king's body transported to the Seine, where it was taken by boat to Caen for burial. The events of William's funeral at Caen are equally strange. As the body was carried to the church of Saint-Étienne, a fire broke out in the town, disrupting the procession. Following Mass, Bishop Gilbert of Evreux delivered an eloquent sermon to a congregation made up of clergy and only a small number of laymen. Neither Robert Curthose nor William Rufus was in attendance. Only William's youngest son, Henry, was present. Before the body could be buried, a man called Asselin stepped forward. "This ground is mine," he proclaimed. "The king took it from me when this church was built and gave me no compensation." The clergy, judging the case right then and there, determined that Asselin was correct and compensated him. When the attendants finally began lowering the body into the grave, they found that the king's corpse was too swollen to fit into its final resting place. An attempt was made to force the body in, which caused it to rupture, releasing a putrid smell that prompted everyone to shrink back. In life, William I of England had not been a beloved king, but rather a feared one. The chaos that accompanied his death reveals something about the contradictory situation created by his career. On the one hand, he was a gifted politician who instilled order through his personal drive and determination. On the other hand, the project of the English conquest had been traumatic and devastating, and the newly established cross-channel empire seemed rife with uncertainty. As it turned out, William laid the foundations for the Angevin Empire, which would endure until the 13th century. Norman political sensibilities played no small part in this. Perhaps the most striking aspect of William's final will is the cleaving of Normandy from England. In life, the king had labored tirelessly to unite the two. Robert Curthose might have inherited both England and Normandy, but the relationship between father and son had been horribly strained by Robert's multiple rebellions. To understand William's final decision, historian David Bates reminds us that, among the Normans, succession was determined by the will of the dying ruler, but also by the consensus of the great men who followed him. Robert Curthose could not simply be disinherited, as this would prompt a reaction from the Norman nobility. Bates believes that William was not only unhappy with his eldest son's rebelliousness, but he had come to believe that Robert Curthose did not have the hardness necessary to be an effective ruler. Thus, William the Conqueror foresaw a situation of almost certain war among his sons. Dividing the realm was damage control. William at least left his sons with an obligation to collaborate. Other historians have not been so generous as Bates. Frank Barlow describes William's decision as the dismemberment of a great achievement done in anger, bitterness, and sorrow, pointing to William's stubbornness toward Robert Curthose. Although he'd not attended the funeral, William Rufus commissioned a tomb of gold, silver, and precious stones to be placed over his father's grave. But this has not survived. Today, only a plain stone slab marks the burial site of King William the Conqueror. The Anglo-Saxon Chronicle provides a haunting epitaph. He who was earlier a powerful king and lord of many a land, he had nothing of any land but a 7-foot measure. And he who was at times clothed with gold and with jewels, he lay then covered over with earth. If you like this video, check out my novel of the Crusades, Why Does the Heathen Rage? Click the link below.